Hello, scientists. Welcome to Tokyo, Japan, a bustling city with a population of over 14 million people. With all of these people, there are a lot of homes, roads, trains, shopping centers, all of the buildings and infrastructure that are essential for an urban metropolis. Tokyo isn't just any city, though. It was designed with a focus on sustainability and connecting people with nature. So how does one of the most crowded cities in the world still manage to have green spaces and reduce the environmental impacts of urban development? Today we'll explore how urbanization impacts the environment and what cities like Tokyo are doing to balance development with sustainability. After the Industrial Revolution, the way human societies used land space changed drastically. Instead of small towns and communities spread out over a large land area, more and more people became concentrated in smaller areas. This process is called urbanization, which is the growth of cities as people move from rural to urban areas. Today, over half of all people on Earth live in a city, and the human population keeps growing. But urbanization isn't just about a concrete jungle like Tokyo. It also focuses on the increase in suburbs, the areas around big city centers. In fact, in the US, over 90% of all population growth has occurred in suburbs. In the suburbs, though, people and buildings are usually more spread out. What makes big cities so unique is the high population density, or the number of people living in a given area. And when population density gets too high, it can lead to urban sprawl when big cities take up more land space and spread into surrounding suburbs. As more and more people move into cities, more buildings are needed, taking away green spaces and natural areas. When you think about urbanization or big cities, what are all the types of buildings that come to mind? Pause here to brainstorm as many as you can. Maybe you thought about industrial factories, shopping malls, or high-rise apartments. It's actually all of these and more. There are three key types of land use in urban areas. The first is commercial land use. What do you think this includes? It includes things like businesses, shopping centers, offices, and museums. The next type is residential land use, which includes any space where people live. In the suburbs, this may look like standalone houses or small condo communities. In cities, townhouses or high-rise apartments help fit more people into a smaller building footprint. And sometimes mixed-use developments combine residential and commercial land use, with buildings that have both shopping centers or offices and apartment units. The last type is industrial land use. Factories, warehouses, and infrastructure like roads and transport systems fall under this category. Are you noticing a theme? Urbanization means a lot of buildings. With so many people, all of these buildings are essential. But what are the impacts of using the land for all of these buildings instead of for green space? There are some major advantages to urbanization. Imagine that you lived in a big city, or if you do live in a big city, think about your own community. What are some benefits of living in an urban area? Pause the video here and record your thoughts. In big cities, people are close together, so it's easier to coordinate community activities. There's usually easy access to public transportation or sidewalks. There are lots of options for resources and businesses like restaurants, doctor's offices, and grocery stores. And with so many different people in a small area, people from different social and cultural backgrounds can interact and learn about one another. These benefits are important, but urbanization doesn't just have social impacts. There are also massive environmental costs to consider. How do you think high population densities impact the demand for natural resources like food, water, timber, and other building materials? demand for resources is high right now. Without a clear focus on intergenerational equity and intentional planning, people could use resources too quickly and deplete them for future generations. Additionally, cities don't just use a lot of resources. They also create huge amounts of waste. Trash and recycling, wastewater, and industrial waste must be carefully managed in big cities. And there's also a concern about space. As urban sprawl continues, expanding cities can reduce natural habitats. This can harm wildlife and decrease biodiversity in important ecosystems like wetlands or forests. The damage extends beyond plant and animal species, too. Since concrete and asphalt absorb heat, the temperature in cities is higher than in nearby rural areas. This is called the urban heat island effect, and it can make cities hotter, increase energy use for air conditioning, and contribute to climate change. Paving over soil, wetlands, and forests for roads or buildings can also impact the water cycle. Think back to what you know about the water cycle. When it rains, what happens to the water that falls on soil and plants? Pause the video here to record your thoughts. Soil and plants are great at absorbing rainfall, but unlike soil, the pavement in cities can't soak up water. Instead, the water runs off the surface, which can throw off the balance of the whole water cycle and carry pollution to nearby bodies of water. It can also cause dangerous flooding in some cities. Finally, traffic and industrial factories in big cities can release greenhouse gases, like carbon dioxide, into the air. Just like pavement affects the water cycle, these emissions can throw off the whole carbon cycle in urban areas. Luckily, most cities are carefully designed by city planners. Their job? To accommodate growing populations while balancing sustainable solutions. Let's see how Tokyo's urban planning highlights some of these creative design solutions. Tokyo, one of the world's most populated cities, faces major urban challenges: pollution, land use, waste creation, and biodiversity loss. Yet the city is committed to sustainability. The Tokyo Metropolitan Government has set ambitious goals for 2030 to become cleaner and greener. So how are they doing it? And what can we learn from their urban design? Tokyo's first lesson: use recycled building materials whenever possible. Since Japan's construction materials recycling law was enacted in 2000, about 90% of major construction materials in Japan are recycled. Using recycled materials reduces the demand for timber and mined resources, allowing cities to expand without depleting resources for future generations. For example, steel, one of the most recycled materials, can replace wood and concrete in new buildings, improving resource efficiency and intergenerational equity. But land is also a limited resource, and big cities are usually already packed with paved roads and buildings. In Tokyo, Odomachi's urban villages use limited space efficiently, and people live, work, and shop in one place. Mixed-use developments can save space by combining residential and commercial buildings into one place. But limited space can also make it tricky to add beneficial plants back into urban areas. How could city planners add green space back into cities without spreading out? Pause the video here to record your ideas. Instead of developing out, cities can build up. Green roofs and vertical gardens, like the ones in Tokyo, add plants without taking up new land. These plants help reduce air pollution, cool off buildings, and can help balance the water cycle. City planners can also reduce air pollution by rethinking transportation. Walkable city designs, bike paths, and public transit like buses or trains reduce the greenhouse gas emissions from individual cars and can also reduce traffic jams. Tokyo uses this urban planning strategy with its metro system, bicycle lanes, and limited car access in busy districts. Finally, city planners have to manage water resources creatively. Tokyo showcases an amazing example of this. The world's largest underground flood diversion facility is found beneath the city. This massive collection of tunnels and reservoirs redirects stormwater underground, helping prevent floods and protecting nearby aquatic ecosystems from pollution. City planners can design wastewater treatment facilities and flood prevention methods to help urban areas use water resources efficiently and to protect people and the environment. These are just a handful of examples of sustainable urban design, but they highlight how creative solutions can help cities grow without harming future generations. As we went through the lesson today, we explored how urban areas use land. Urbanization has major environmental impacts, but smart planning can reduce them. Tokyo provides a real-world example of how we can balance high population density with sustainable planning. Until next time, remember, cities are more than just buildings and roads. They're living systems shaped by the choices we make. Urbanization brings challenges, but it also offers opportunities for innovation, creativity, and sustainability. Keep learning and thinking creatively, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.